The setup's based off of a 7-year-old laptop that's somehow still running, and generally I'm working in Ableton Live. Sometimes I work in Logic or Pro Tools depending on what kind of work needs to get done, but if it's writing and sort of composing or making beats or sound design, this kind of stuff, I like to do it in Ableton now because of how Mac's MSP interfaces with Ableton. I started digging into Macs a lot in the last 2.5 years or so, and now it's become an essential part of the composition process for me. The sequencing generally, what happens is simple patterns or whatever get sort of devised in Ableton Live, and then I have a suite of Max devices that I've been working on for years now that looks at incoming MIDI and manipulates it in different ways. It manipulates timing, it manipulates repetition, velocities. It's basically a filtering system for any MIDI that comes in, and then it changes it on the way out. And it's sort of a way of completely disregarding ideas like tempo and meter, which has always been particularly interesting to me about freeing music from these types of constraints that it doesn't necessarily, in my opinion, have to abide by. There are a bunch of different devices that do this. I have a clocking system, and then I have another one that's just a polyphonic MIDI note repeater, a couple of polyphonic MIDI note delay with a curvable delay time, and all of this stuff is syncable to a master system called Gilt. And Gilt can send signals and timing signals to all of these other devices so that everything can play together, out of time, together. Or you can send modulation signals that are not to Ableton's clock, but to the Gilt clock. But then, you know, you can modulate things in Ableton and draw automation to this clocking system and not to the Ableton clocking system. It took me a long time to figure out how to implement it, and I didn't know exactly what the implications of it were gonna be, or the ramifications of it, or in which direction I was gonna go with it, or what the goal was. And so it's constantly changing now. It's this sort of ecosystem of devices that all work together, and it's constantly evolving. I'm constantly finding little bugs, or, oh, why don't I change it so that, you know, that envelope can be shaped with the mouse, and so I don't have to use knobs, or cosmetic changes, technical changes that constantly. That's half of what I do. Basically, my day is I wake up and I start working on Max MSP stuff till about midday. And then at midday, I sort of switch over to the writing part of it, because otherwise I'll just program for the rest of my life. This lunchbox here is pretty much one of the only things that doesn't really change much. My setup has pretty much been the same for, I don't know, probably 10 years now. The API 512s are sort of my workhorse preamps. I use them as a synth DI a lot of the time, or a guitar or bass DI, or if I were gonna play the Rhodes again, I would probably play it through that. And then I have a Neve to go straight to the Shadow Hills mono optograph. It's an opto compressor mono, and that's sort of the vocal chain. Sometimes I'll plug the microphone into the 512 and then into the Shadow Hills, but generally it's Neve to Shadow Hills. It has a really pillowy, sort of papery vocal sound that I like it a lot. It's been on vocal chain for many years now. The Rolly is this thing that I love it. It feels pretty cool. It doesn't feel like an instrument that I've ever been familiar with, but it also does a lot of things that I haven't really fully wrapped my brain around as far as MPE, which is sort of based in the idea of MIDI, but it takes it a lot further, and it's much more gestural. Each note can have a whole bunch of different types of data that it sends to the software, and I found it to be a really expressive instrument for that reason. And it interfaces beautifully with Max MSP. And Max can look at all the data that this thing sends and send it out to all kinds of different places where it can get changed and manipulated and it can feed into other things. A lot of my sound sources are just stock Ableton and stock Native Instruments stuff. You can buy out my entire rig and all the software at Guitar Center. There's nothing mystical about any of it. I like to sort of make things bespoke. With that said, you know, if I'm using a Reactor ensemble that's a common one, I'll definitely dig into it. And if it's some sort of sample-based thing, I'll definitely put my own stuff into it. And I don't like to use presets too much. I think presets are a fun way to kind of scroll through and see what something can do to sort of give you an idea or give you a sort of a general guide of what something can do, but I don't think you're really supposed to use them. I'm obsessed with things sounding sort of artificially large or spacious or gigantic, and I'm not shy with reverb. There's never such a thing as too much reverb, and I like things to sound artificially wide, but then also I like things to sound tiny. I like to establish that there's a gigantic space sometimes and then play with something really small in there. You put something tiny in this huge space, then it gives you an idea of scale. You know, there might be a little melody that just gets EQ'd down to nothing. It's barely there and it's really quiet and it's kind of panned off, and then it's maybe got something on it that makes it sound like it's breaking, or I run into a crappy old Walkman and sort of degrade it and then bring it back in. So it's this tiny little thing in this gigantic context of something big and hi-fi or whatever. I like this kind of juxtaposition. I like to give you something beautiful and then I like to break it. Like, here, look at this cool vase. Smash, you know. That's kind of my musical MO. I don't want it to be too perfect for too long. It's like sometimes, you know, you have a bowl of pasta, you have one bite, and it's like, that was amazing. That was enough though. I don't need any more. Or it's like ice cream. You have a spoon of ice cream, like, wow, that was great. Okay, I'm not gonna eat any more of that though. One was enough.